This is the 1791 Dudley engine, if you live in the US. If you live in the UK, you might actually know it as the windmill end engine. I'm Darren, and this was the Industrial Revolution. The engine operated in the West Midlands coal field out of the Cobb engine house. Ran at windmill end pit number 3 near Netherton, in the area near Dudley in the United Kingdom. Here you can see how the engine looked in the late 1870s. The building in the background, as well as the covered walkway connecting them, were later removed well before the mine closed down. Although it doesn't look it, this is actually a combined winding and pumping engine. Winding engines, also called WIMS or WIMSIs, are the hoist engine used in a mine, used to carry miners and equipment up and down and remove ore from the mine. This engine was likely built by James Picard around 1791, and although we don't know that for sure, we do know for sure that the crank on this side, which turns the up and down motion from the overhead beam into the rotary motion, that was definitely invented by James Picard. Part of the reason for its anonymity may be that it did violate a few patents held by James Watt. So we look inside, see the large single acting cylinder. It's an atmospheric engine. It's a 28-inch bore cylinder with a 5-foot stroke. It's capable of producing about 20 horsepower at 30 RPM. One of the patents it violated was a James Watt patent for the external condenser, which this sort of uses. If you look through the vent in the bottom of the building, you see there's what's called a pickle pot that served that purpose. I'm sorry about the lighting in here, but if you look up at the very top of the cylinder and up towards the beam, you see where there would normally be a single straight vertical piston rod, there's actually 5 rods. Now, the 2 on the outside are fixed vertical rails. And you see there's a horizontal bar across it, and that rides up and down on the rails. The next 2 from each side, those are connected directly to the piston, and those are also connected directly to that horizontal bar. And those serve the role of the piston rod moving up and down. In the center, you have the square bar, and that connects up to this horizontal bar as well. But as you can see, it actually is not connected rigidly to that horizontal bar. It's allowed to move freely back and forth in there, and that takes up the slack that you'd have from the main engine beam, which forms an arc as it moves back and forth. Using this mechanism allowed them to avoid the patent that James Watt held on the parallel motion. I mentioned this is a single acting piston. That means that the piston can only pull down in this case, which will pull its end of the main overhead rod down, pushes this end up. Now the crank, which normally would just be a straight bar if you had a double acting cylinder, has this huge metal weight bolted to the side of it. And that's done to pull this back down. Single acting cylinders were perfect if you were running a mine pump or a canal pump, for example, as the heavy weight of the shaft would pull it back down. But for a rotary engine, that didn't work. This is a rotary engine.
The crank allowed you to connect to this large flywheel. The flywheel basically served to smooth out the motion. Reciprocating engines of any kind tend to be a little jerky. But by putting a heavy flywheel on it, you smoothed out the motion. That connects over to this gearing. Connects first to the small gear, which connects to the large gear, and finally to the main drum. Now this is a winding engine as part of its duty. And a winding engine would have a cable put around this, over a tower, and then down a mine shaft. That'd be used to raise and lower workers and equipment. It would also allow you to pull coal up out of the mine. You might be wondering how they actually operated this thing. And to operate it as a whimsy, here is a hoisting engine, you would actually manually operate the valves. Back in the engine house, the cylinder in the background and this large pipe in the front with the wheel valve on it, that actually is the main steam inlet source. And at the bottom, you see the lever. The lever here actually controls whether you let steam into the piston or not. Unlike some steam engines, this one, by using the pickle pot connected directly to a short pipe, it did that with a separate valve. You'd open this, that would allow steam into the piston, into the cylinder. Piston would go up. When it reached the top, you'd close it, inject some cold water, that would condense it back down, create vacuum. The piston would go to the bottom. If you needed to reverse direction, you just simply didn't let the valve go all the way to the top, or the piston didn't go all the way to the top before you hit it with the water, and that'd reverse the direction of the wheel. If you imagine the wheel here is rotating counterclockwise, that crank is going to be coming towards us, and when it's about halfway up, pointed straight to our right, you stop letting steam in, and hit it with a bit of chilled water. Now that condenses the steam and creates vacuum, it changes the direction. So now the crank starts going the other direction and the wheel's turning the other way. Lets you change the direction of your hoist. Over here for the hoist, the cable wraps around here, again over the top of a tower and down into the mine. The geometry when you start looking into these things is really great. So keen observers have probably noticed one thing missing, and that's a brake. You control the steam, you can control the jet of water to condense, but there's no brake on this. Now, unfortunately, there aren't many of these still surviving today. In fact, according to one source, there's actually only 3 single-acting steam piston winding engines left on the planet. 2 of them are in this museum here at the Henry Ford Museum in Dearborn, Michigan. And the other one here does have a brake. There's a good chance this had a brake on it when it was operating, and it just didn't have a brake on it at this time. Could have been on it when it was purchased and not reinstalled, or perhaps it wasn't even there when the engine was purchased. So as we've been walking around this engine and showing it off, You remember I said this was actually a pumping engine as well. And you're probably noticing something missing here. There is no pump. There's no pump mechanism. There's no pump shaft. There's no indication of how this originally pumped water. And that confused me the first time I came here to film it, as I was expecting a pump shaft. And unfortunately, there's not a great answer. One thing we do know, though, is that it did, in fact, pump water. In fact, this engine pumped 1.6 million liters of water per day. It's about 423,000 gallons per day. And it pumped it up to 525 feet. The amount of water is about 2.5 Olympic-sized swimming pools. So this pumped a lot of water. So how did it go about doing that? Well, I was wondering that too. And then I found another engine, nearly the identical twin of this one. It's called the Farm Colliery engine in England. And they had the same question. They had the same engine, nearly identical, same dates. They knew it too was a pump. They knew how much water it pumped, roughly. They didn't know how. Let's take a look at this drum here a little bit closer. Some of the wear here on a couple of these boards. Some of these boards at least are original, possibly all of them are. We have definite rope marks across here, and we get over to the far end, and those are cut smooth. What would do that? Well, we do have some historic photos, both of this engine and of the farm colliery engine, and they both look about the same. They have the same engine house, and they have the same, not one, but two towers that these cables fed over. So what was going on? Well, the best guess they've come up with, and the best guess I can come up with, is that you actually ran two different cables over this, depending on what you wanted to do. If you wanted to run this as a hoist engine, you'd put your hoisting cable on it. That would wrap up and down as needed. And it'd simply operate as you'd expect. Now, if you wanted to run it as a pump, on the other hand, you take the hoisting cable off and you use this big drum behind me as a capstan. You've probably seen those on big ships. They're the horizontal drums. And by pulling very gently, you can actually apply a lot of force, raise anchors and things, for example. If you wrapped your cable around here, up over the top of the tower, and down to an off-center wheel, and that wheel was connected to a pump shaft, the off-center nature of the wheel would tend to cause it to spin around, raise the pump shaft up and down, and that could operate as a pump. And if you look at the photos, you see in both of them, you have the engine house, then you have the center tower has a large wheel just below the top, and it has two wheels above it. And then you have the next tower over, all the way on the left, and that actually has a single off-center wheel. And you can see it's clearly off-center. And that's the case with both of these mines. So it looks like what you would do is you'd change your cable out. And if you were pumping, you'd wrap it around here a couple times and feed it over both of those first tower's pulleys to the second tower's a single loop, and just run this engine continuously, just like you do with a normal pumping engine. And that continuous operation, and it is set up in there to be able to do continuous as well with the plug tree, that would allow you to pump continuously. So we don't really know the absolute earliest history of this engine. We believe it was built about 1791, but don't know where it was installed at that point. In 1831, it was moved to Windmill End, where it served the rest of its life. Operated there until about 1920, and in the 1920s, miner strikes throughout the region effectively shut down the mine, and the mine officially closed in 1925. The engine was still there and still operating in 1928 when a buyer for Henry Ford went to the site.
saw it operating and purchased it to move it here to Henry Ford Museum in Dearborn, Michigan. As I mentioned, this is one of only three surviving engines of this type on the entire planet. And that's why this is the Industrial Revolution.